Hi guys, welcome to the Bribe Planning channel, and today we're going to be talking about relationships and money. So this video is for those people who are looking to start a new relationship or an existing relationship. I'm just going to talk about money matters that you guys should be considering in order to build your wealth together, married or unmarried. Let's do this, guys. My name is Brad Putney, and my 7 years experience as an accountant and wealth advisor has made me realize that people lack a functional relationship with money. I'm here to help. First, financial impressions last. Remember guys, it's very important how you portray yourself in a relationship, especially at the beginning. Avoid extravagant dates, avoid, you know, over the top presents, vacations that you know very well if it was the first time you ever did it trying to impress this person, it will become a problem later because now you're creating a precedent whereby this person will expect these type of stuff in the relationship, and you know very well that was literally your first time going through a vacation and now it's expected every week. So be very careful. Now some tips to remember is that you need to stick to your financial lane. I know that is those cloud statements whereby people are just showing off and whatnot, but it's super true actually, because at the end of the day, when you know how much you can afford, what you do when you need to do something fun, you know it personally. Make sure you get somebody that can enjoy, you know, what you enjoy at the same budget that you actually enjoy it, rather than now you are used to date, you know, going out by yourself, you spend about 500 rand. Now this person, you're spending 1.5, 2,000, you understand? Some extent 10,000, because now you're going on vacations. Now this is killing your budget. You probably could be eating your savings away. And at the end of the day, what this doing is, it's gonna cause problems later in your relationship. So remember that first, financial impressions last, and avoid create an impression that you know that you cannot sustain later in the relationship. Otherwise, you're going to be investing in a relationship whereby you are putting yourself in a 50-50 chance to win or lose that relationship simply because you gave the wrong financial impression about yourself. So be careful. You and your partner must develop good financial habits. Financial awareness between partners is very critical. In fact, without it, it could lead to unfulfilled financial expectations and fat and sit situations. Remember, each partner's or each individual's strength and opportunities must benefit the other individual's weaknesses and threats. In other words, you guys balance one another. That is the greatest, you know, position, particularly from a financial point of view, that you can approach a relationship when the relationship is mutually benefiting all the partners involved. So that's very critical. So based on good financial habits, this is one way for you guys to share some key information on what your perspectives of money are, because sometimes you could be dating somebody that is a financial boffin and the other one isn't. That does not mean that the one who's the financial boffin is the only one that's going to dictate financial related topics, because at the end of the day, it's not about showing who knows better and whatnot, but it's a matter of listening to one another. You listen to one another's perspective towards money, because most times in relationship, power dynamics are determined by the one who is, you know, making the income or who's making the most income. And the mistake that a lot of people in relationships make is that the one who has the power determines what is done with the power. This is totally wrong. In a relationship, both partners are able to partake equally in these conversations. Money is one of the resources of the family, right? Or of your guys' relationship that you guys decide both on. And why this is important, because in those stereotypical relationships whereby, let's say, the male is the one who is, you know, bringing in the money, and the woman, let's say, just to be very stereotypical, she's not working. Now that does not mean she does not know anything about finances, but now imagine, now she plays the lotto, she gets the money. Now because, you know in these stereotypical, you know, relationships, when somebody has the money, they tend to be, you know, very pompous about it, and it can make the other partner feel a little bit left out and, you know, not involved. So imagine that person wins the lotto and then she now has the power. What then? All of a sudden that guy's gonna be redundant. That's not right. And guess what? She's gonna make sure I'm feliz at the end of the day, you know? Because why? She was ostracized simply because she didn't have money. Now she has the money. Now, you know, the financial habits could go everywhere. So it's very, very key for you guys to understand who's the saver of the relationship. Are you guys frugal? Make those decisions together. Affect one another. Because yes, you guys will have opposing views or you will share views. Either way, the important thing is to do things together. Understand that when we have 100 grand, I know how she's gonna think, I know how he's going to think. Good financial habits. How you guys treat money is very important, and it's very important for each of you guys to be aware of one another. You know, I know some situations where guys don't even tell their women how much they earn. This is, I don't understand why, because in my household, we tell each other everything. All the money that comes, all the opportunities that I'm aware of, I tell her. Even though, you know, my partner is not a financially, you know, she's not a financial person like myself. She's more psychological and, you know, all about well-being and all those things. But now, what happens is, I use her as a moral compass. I use her as a way of understanding money from somebody else that's non-financial. And that's very key, because most of the time financial people can be very shrewd, can be very robotic in terms of their relationship with money, in terms of how it's managed. And sometimes it's not always about being robotic. You need to have a fluid relationship whereby both partners contribute equally, because that's where those unique, you know, love building, relationship building, wealth building relationship decisions that are being made. Because at the end of the day, it's an informed decision by, as the old saying goes, two heads are better than one. Talk about your financial philosophies. Bouncing from the good financial habits topic, this is a more advanced position whereby the key here is for you guys to talk literally about what you think about money. What is your perspective? Thing is, avoid being with someone that financially depletes you, because this can also, in a worst case scenario, affect your future plans or your financial future. Because in the relationships, as we are told, it's all about sacrifice, how you know, forgo this for the greater good of, you know, your partner and so on. This is very borderline shady, and you know, there's a lot of gray area, because we know gender roles end up prevailing, and the expectation on the male to perform and bring income, and the male to protect and, you know, sustain the household. Those are not good outlooks of a relationship, and that's why it's very important for you guys to discuss the philosophies. Because when you're building a relationship, key relationship eventualities, like how are you guys going to build a home, it's very important to discuss. Whether one partner believes on renting, the other believes on getting a home loan, the other believes in buying an, you know, an already built house, or do you guys build your new home? How you navigate those type of strategies is very important, and that's why it needs to be discussed. Because at the end of the day, it's all about how you guys build the future together. And when you guys both partake and agree, you work towards towards those futures in a more efficient and very effective manner. The next thing is raising kids. When you guys are expecting a bundle of joy, what is going to happen? You expect the mother to stay at home and basically, you know, get lost in the motherhood of just her staying at home and not being able to continue her career or something that she dreamt of. It's very important to discuss these things, because it's not right. A lot of relationships of what happens is, you know, the males, when the baby is born, they're able to do whatever they want, versus the women, they are expected to just, you know, you know, they're just there to raise the babies, and that's not right. I mean, to be personal about this, in my relationship, what we ended up agreeing on is we're not going to take our child to school up until he's, you know, between the ages of 2 and 3, and we're confident to take him then. We made a mutual decision that, okay, my wife will sit at home and she will be, you know, basically we'll homeschool our child, we'll grow him. But that didn't mean that I have a free role to do whatever I want. What that meant, I have to take on the financial responsibility. And that's what we agreed on. And when we agreed on that, I agreed that I will work from home, or if I have to go, I will go work, come back immediately. And when I come back, it's my turn. Because I have to, you know, we have to give each other roles whereby we give each other time to recover. We perform and recover, perform and recover. So it didn't matter what needed to be done. It didn't really matter what needed to be done. If I had to take care of the nappies, or it got to a situation that I'm the one who's fully in charge of the nappies, because she didn't like to do that. I make sure that the baby's clean, I buffer them, I do all those type of things, and I give her a break. When she needs to sleep, she does what she needs to do at the end of the day. So it's very, very key to be able to do these type of things whereby you guys support one another, you guys help one another, and this is not just about you guys, you know, taking advantage of each other's situations in a relationship. Make sure you mutually do things that benefit one of you guys. And when you guys share your philosophy, that's where you start learning about your partner, what they think, how they do things. And this is, you know, a very good way to get to know one another in terms of your relationship, because these are key moments of life whereby you understand your partner from the beginning. And also another thing that I must not forget is family management. We know that when the money is involved and you guys have to deal with your individual families, it can be a problem, because at the end of the day, one family is going to be benefiting financially from the relationship than the other, and that can become a problem. Discuss it, guys. Maybe start having a savings of some sort, or some sort of fund whereby, you know, this is the money dedicated for family members, and there's a way that you guys disperse funds per family member. Be careful, do not financially frustrate one another. Know each other's philosophies, get to know each other much more better. Money is the biggest reason why couples fight. I'm sure any one of you right now that has been in a relationship or that is about to start in a relationship has been in that type of fight, the financial fight. This is not an abnormal thing, it's absolutely normal, because finances are very, you know, critical and very sensitive, because at the end of the day, we all have feelings that we introduce that, you know, change the dynamics of the relationship. And it's very important to be, you know, knowing each other, because at the end of the day, what that does, it gives each other an opportunity to have, you know, a predetermined estimation or perspective of one another's feelings towards money. And that's where it makes the fights a little bit more less intense, but it makes them purposeful, because yes, you guys will be fighting about money and all those things, but at the end of the day, the key thing is, how do you come out stronger once you have those fights? Because those fights are mere disagreements that need to be ironed out and take you guys to the next level of your relationship. And that's why, you know, all the tips leading to this one right now, it's very important to understand that yes, you guys will fight about money, but the more you observe the other tips, is the more that the fight become less about showing off or less about proving how the other person needs the other and such, you know, toxic sort of ideas. But it's more about building each other, because we fight because we care. We fight because we want to express something that's important that needs to be looked at. So it's very, very key for you guys to just understand that and get to a point whereby when you do all of these financial, you know, decisions, whether it's big or small, that you guys then do it together. It's about sticking together and making powerful, informed decisions. That's the whole point of this. You will make better decisions together, because those decisions get criticized in real time. Those decisions develop a deeper sense of trust, which is very, very important in relationship, that you guys will need for many other things as you go through your, you know, marriage life, relationship life, whatever life that you decide to go together. Be strong, be powerful. Financial positions, the last draw in terms of what you need to be aware of when, you know, you guys are going through the courting process, or you're just merely managing your current relationship and you're just trying to have better financial planning or introduce financial goals in order to build wealth. So financial position is really understanding what is the net worth of your partner. Yes, this is a very difficult question to ask, however the answers can be easy. And one of the things to be aware of here is, we're talking about, in accounting terms, which is the accounting equation. You look at your assets equals your liabilities plus equity. So what does that stand for? Your assets are basically things like, you know, let me rather put it this way, assets are things which generate economic inflows or economic benefits towards your life. So anything that you buy that is something that you purchase from a past event, you purchase in a particular period, and you use it, or you own it and use it to develop something that benefits you economically. So in other words, you buy a home, it might not benefit you financially, but it'll benefit you in terms of giving you safety, a place to sleep, a place whereby you can develop yourself, and all these things that are actual benefits to you, to help you to economically and otherwise you know, thrive and survive. So, or survive and thrive. So it's very important to understand that, yes, you buy a home or you have houses, whatever the case may be, those are assets that give you, you know, benefits in terms of furthering your wealth creation. Other things is like a car. Yes, a car. A car is an asset. Why? Regardless of how you purchase it, the most important thing is when you have the car, it has a particular value, and that value is also expressed or it's experienced when you use it, whether you go to work, whether you go, you know, anywhere that you know that economically you will be benefiting. And also other things that just give you a benefit in terms of your life, because if you don't have a car, you'll climb on a taxi. That is not an asset when you're climbing a taxi, but when you own the car, it's sitting in your garage, in your piece of land, wherever you stay, that is your asset. So how you balance these things out is on the other side, because now you look at liabilities or you look at equity. So we'll start with liabilities. What are liabilities? Liabilities is things like credit. It's how you get access to income or finances that help you to get assets. And this is where now, going back to the car example, whereby if you want to get a car, you don't have the money to be able to purchase the car in full and own it. You have to borrow that money from somewhere else, and that's where the credit comes in. So what confuses people and why they like to say a car is not an asset is because the car, let's say, costs 100,000. Now you need to borrow 100,000 from the bank. So what happens in terms of the accounting equation? You have 100,000 on the left side, and now you have 100,000 that you've raised on the right side. So there's zero benefit, but now there's still what we call interest, because now you're borrowing money. So instead of borrowing money, let's assume a 30% interest, you're borrowing the money not just at 100,000, but you're borrowing it at 130,000. Now your accounting equation is imbalanced, because now your credit is outweighing your asset, and that's why now your assets become a very painful thing. Now that leads us to the middle, which is your equity. So equity is basically your ability to generate income, how you pay for your lifestyle. So that's why equity plus liabilities equals your assets, because the balance between those two, which is where now how you are going to pay that 30% plus paying off the loan, that's how you're going to balance it, by the equity that you're able to generate. And that's why you need to qualify when you are being assessed to qualify for a loan or any credit facility. They look at your equity, how much income do you make, and that's what will end up balancing you should you be able to secure a loan and you need to be able to pay it back. So in essence, you look at this equation. You have an asset, for example, 100,000 worth of a car. You have your equity. Let's say now you make enough money to qualify. That means you're going to be granted that 130,000, you know, loan that you need to pay back. What balances your equation is your equity, your ability to pay off whatever that supports your life. So it's very important in a relationship aspect to understand these aspects. You know, you need to know what is the credit score of your partner. Why this is important? It's not for you to benefit and get all these expensive. No, it's for you guys to make financial decisions in terms of building your wealth, in terms of building the basics. Because you guys, you need a home to stay, you need a home to build on. If you guys don't have one, you're going to be probably renting, or you're going to be living, you know, off your parents, whatever the case may be. And they plan for progression. You don't want to stay where you are. You want to move forward. So it's very key to know each other's financial positions in order to make informed decisions. Sometimes you have a negative past financial life. That's important for your partner to know that, because what this does, it helps them to make an informed decision. So you guys, when you're together, you know, based on the past, this is the things that you got wrong. Let's see how we can improve to avoid the temptations of, you know, falling for that trap again. We need to know the financial present and the financial future of your partner. So all this is all about financial positioning, because at the end of the day, it's all about making informed decisions. The more information you have about any given thing about each other is the more that you guys can proactively deal with the things that push you back and focus on the things that make you guys go forward. So it's very, very key to understand all of these, you know, aspects of financial planning, which is the financial position of each partner, how you guys benefit one another, how you guys bring what you bring in terms of financial resources to benefit the relationship for the better. Because at the end of the day, where you start determines how you can understand the sins of the past and how you can maximize your blessings of the future, because at the end of the day, you want to look forward. You don't want to be ostracizing people based on what they did in the past or the mistakes that they did. At the end of the day, you want to understand your person a little bit better, and that's what it's all about. This is not to be like, hey, I'm going to be benefiting simply because this person has a higher financial position than me and suddenly. No, this is important because you guys want to share each other's accomplishments. You want to share each other's failures, share each other's, you know, benefits towards each other, so that an informed decision can be made. So you guys can decide, are you gonna start a business? Are we gonna start a business? Can we start a business? How do we start a business? Simply because you know your financial positioning. Very key, guys. So yeah, thanks for watching. Really appreciate your time. I hope these will help as we, you know, experience our lockdown. I hope this is some resource to just help you learn and just fun conversation started between your new bae or your new, or your, you know, your current bae, whatever the case may be. Like I said, this is not just for married people. This is for anybody that's in a relationship, but you're looking to build a financial future with the person that you're with.